All righty. Joshua chapter 7 is where we are, and we're making some powerful choices, I hope. That's really the reason behind this study. Also, you know, if you don't have a Bible, there's plenty of them all around. There's some orange ones and some yellow ones. We'll get some verses up onto the screen. While you're turning there, just kind of review exactly what's going on here in our study of Joshua. Of course, the children of Israel were in Egypt, and finally the Pharaoh lets them go, and Moses leads them out into the desert. They're going to go over to the promised land. It should have only taken, you know, like 11, 12 days. They're out there 40 years. They're just not obeying. They're just messing up. They're stubborn Hebrews. And so they take 40 years out there. Well, finally they get over to the promised land. The only thing between them now and their goal is this Jordan River, which is overflowing its banks. And so they have to cross over this river. And we saw that happen. The priests with the Ark of the Covenant, they step into the water, and the water stops, and it dries out completely, and 2 million people go across the river. And now, as if that's not enough, now they get across, and now they get to the most famous part of the story of Joshua, I'm sure, and that is the walls of Jericho, right? So we've got this walled city, and within, and I'm talking about like really tall, you know, cement, like if you will, walls, and it protects the city so that no invading armies could get in there. But rest assured, inside that walled city, there is an army awaiting to fight anyone that would invade. And so they march up to Jericho, and they march around the city for 6 days. And then on the seventh day, they march around the city seven times. And then when Joshua gives a command, they all start screaming. And how many, just honestly, like, how many of them actually thought that this was going to work, right? I mean, it's kind of a wacky plan. I'm sure that there was some doubt in the room, but they shout at the top of their lungs, and wham, the walls fall down, and in comes the army, and they go and take over the city. And so that's kind of where we leave off, okay? So what happens next, God gives them specific instructions. And before we jump into 7, here in chapter 6, verse 18, God gives specific instructions as to what they're supposed to do once they get into the city. And here it is. In 6:18, it just says this, quotes, this is God, okay? Do not take any of the things set apart for destruction, or you yourselves will be completely destroyed, and you'll bring trouble on the camp of Israel. Everything made from silver, gold, bronze, and iron is sacred to the Lord and must be brought into his treasury. So there's two groups of things. There's either these metals, which is gold, silver, bronze, and iron. Like, those things are supposed to be set apart for the Lord, for his treasury. And then all the other stuff is the stuff that's set for destruction. He wants them to go in and just demolish everything that you see, living and non-living. Just kill it all. Burn it, shred it, kill it. Dead. And then all the rest of that stuff, all these, you know, the silver and gold and all that has to go to the Lord. That's what they were told to do. Okay, now, that's all fine and good until chapter 7 starts. Okay, until chapter 7 starts. And here's what it says, just the first verse. But Israel violated the instructions about the things set apart for the Lord. A man named Achan had stolen some of these dedicated things, so the Lord was very angry with the Israelites. Okay, that being said, I've tried every week to give you like a title, a choice. And so the choice tonight that we have to make is conformity or community. And that's what presents itself here in this story. There's 1,000 things we could talk about in Joshua chapter 7, but what the Lord gave to me is what I'm going to give to you is this difference between conformity and community you choose. Okay, here's the first thing, and this is very, very, very important, and that is this, that your relationship with the Lord absolutely is personal, but it's never in seclusion. Never in seclusion. You aren't saved by your grandma. You're not saved by your grandpa. You're not saved by the town you grew up in. Like, I grew up in a predominantly heavy Jewish town. That doesn't mean I'm good with God. Okay, you're not saved by the heritage that you bring to the table. You're not saved by the church that you attended a few times as you were growing up. No, you are saved by personally accepting the free gift of God, which is eternal life through Christ Jesus. That is the only way that you are to be saved. Now, although we're not saved by those people, we are saved to those people. And now this is an Old Testament story, but it still remains the same today. Even though we're not saved by them, we are saved to them. Now, before we talk about community, let's talk about conformity. And Achan does exactly that. He conforms to the normal ways of the world. And when you read his story, I'm going to read to you what he actually did. You're going to say, man, that sounds awfully familiar. He displays a very common way of life, a common perspective, a common way to live. If you look at verses 20 and 21, you're going to see conformity in action. And the Bible tells us to not copy the behaviors and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. So what you see here is not the way we should think. Look at verse 20 of chapter 7. Achan replies. Now, hold on a second. Look up here. Before this happens, what's happened is that God has singled him out in front of the whole nation. Everyone now knows that's the guy who stole stuff. So he's got the spotlight on him, and this is what it says. Achan steps forward after he's told to make your confession and tell me what you did. Don't hide it. Achan replies, it is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. Among the plunder, I saw a beautiful robe from Babylon, 200 silver coins, and a bar of gold weighing more than a pound. I wanted them so much that I took them. Three things. I saw, I wanted, I took. That's what we do. I. Personal gain. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Wealth and titles and power and position and stuff and this old expression of just trying to get by. Just trying to get by what? Just trying to get by everybody else? Just trying to get ahead of everybody else? That's just the way we think. But you know what? God doesn't think that way. As a matter of fact, I think God was a Southerner. Who agrees with me? You guys think God was a Southerner? I think he was. If you look up in 2 Umatilians, you'll see the word y'all. That's what it says. He doesn't believe in I. He believes in y'all. And what he says here is that, look, he says, Israel violated the instructions. What do you mean Israel violated the instructions? According to this guy Achan was disobedient. Not everybody. But it says Israel violated my instructions. In other words, when Achan did something wrong, the whole community was at fault. See, community, even if it was in the Old Testament or the New, we're intricately woven together. The book of Ephesians says that God places the people in the body perfectly. And as each one of us does his own special work, it helps the others to grow so that the whole body is healthy, growing, and full of love. That's what the body of Christ is. We are intricately woven together. And some might say, well, what I do is my business. Ain't hurting nobody. Did you ever hear anyone say that? Probably yourself. I've done it. But let me just say something and point out something obvious. Achan's sin was personal, right? He did it himself, but the effect was widespread, wasn't it? It was through the whole community. It was kind of like the old football. Whoever played football? Anyone play football here? Yeah, when you mess up, the whole team does push-ups. And this is what's going on here. We're a member of a team. And so the whole, you're going to see if you read chapter 7, that the whole nation pays the penalty for the sins of one man. They go to war. They've been winning battle after battle after battle after battle. And all of a sudden, this happens. And what happens? They go in and the one guy goes and goes, hey, this next battle, I spied it out. This should be no problem. 3,000 or 4,000 guys, we got it. No, 2,000 or 3,000 guys, we got it. So he sends in, just in case, he sends in 3 and they get whooped. And they're like, what's going on? This is what's going on. You guys messed up. We didn't mess up. He messed up. That's right. Y'all are together. You messed up. See, his sin was individual. It was personal, but its effect was widespread. What he did affected others. What I do affects you. What you do affects me. We're saved by one, but we are saved to each other. We are saved to each other. Now, the Bible paints a beautiful picture in the New Testament of what this would look like, and I welcome you to read it with me. It's in 1 Corinthians. Go to 1 Corinthians with me, and let's read this together. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, sometimes you just have to stand back and let God paint a picture in your mind. And what I want you to do here is if you want to read it out of your Bible, you can go ahead and do it. Or you could close your eyes, I'll read it to you, and you can kind of visualize what God is painting here as a community of people together, together. Now I'm going to read actually several verses, 12 through 27, so it's a little lengthy, but we'll glean something from it. All right, here we go. 1 Corinthians 12, 12. The human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ, and that's who we are. Some of us are Jews, some are Gentiles, some are slaves, and some are free. This is a good place for an amen. But we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit, and we all share the same Spirit. Yes, the body has many different parts, not just one part, although I think some people just think that they have one part. As the foot says, I am not a part of the body because I am not a hand. That does not make it any less a part of the body. So this is like self-condemnation, your self-worth. You don't think you're anything. So that's what he's talking about here. I'm not important to the body of Christ. And he's saying, no. You might not think highly of yourself, but you are an integral part of my body. And if the ear says, I am not part of the body because I am not an eye, would that make it any less a part of the body? So it asks a question. What's the answer? Anyone? No. You are part of the body. If the whole body was were an eye, how would you hear? Or if the whole body were an ear, how would you smell anything? It's starting to make sense, right? But the body, look at this. But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants it. See, that's that whole same verbiage that you see in Ephesians where he's placed us together just perfectly. And so when we do our own work that he's assigned us to, the whole body is growing and full of love and healthy. He puts us where he wants according to his good pleasure. Verse 19. How strange a body would be. Here's the part where you envision it in your mind, right? How strange a body would be if it only had one part. So imagine, it's probably not a stretch for you to imagine me walking around just as a big nose. That would be a pretty easy idea, right? So that's what I would be. And that would be kind of foolish, wouldn't it? Well, yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand. So earlier it said that I'm worthless, and God's like, no, you're not, you're important. Now here's the part of the body that says, oh, another person's worthless. The eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. The head can't say to the feet, I don't need you. In fact, some parts of the body that seem weakest and least important are actually the most necessary. And the parts we regard as less honorable are those we clothe with the greatest care. So we carefully protect those parts that should not be seen, while the more honorable parts do not require this special care. So just think about this. Now, I'm not being graphic or gross or funny, but a female chest, okay, yeah, it's used to, you know, for a baby. I mean, that's what its real purpose is, to feed a child, right? Yeah, Lexi says amen. So 90% of a woman's life, they're not even being used for the purpose. But yet we guard them and we protect them, and that's like our private, discreet part. And it's also the same for other parts of the body that, let's face it, most of the time of your life, it's used to remove waste, right? I mean, that's what it's used for. It's used to remove waste. But yet the same, we cover it and protect it, but yet the parts that are, you know, important, if you will, like our faces and our hands, we don't cover those. They're out for the whole world to see. But these parts of us that don't seem to be very important, yet we care for them a great deal. And there's a message in that. And let's read on. It'll tell us what it is. So God has put the body together such that extra honor and care are given to those parts that have less dignity. We're talking about the body of Christ. Now, this is a picture of a human body, and we've talked about the parts that are covered up, that are less dignified. They're not as important, if you will, but we put a lot of care into them. And as a body, what he's saying is that those parts of the body that seem like they have nothing to bring to the table are the ones that those that have a lot to bring to the table have someone to care for and love and nurture. They're important people. They have dignity and value and worth. That's the body of Christ. So God has put the body together such that extra honor and care are given to those parts that have less dignity. This makes for harmony. See this? Gives everybody something to do. It makes for harmony among the members so that all the members care for each other. This part's amazing. If one part suffers, all the parts suffer with it. And if one part is honored, all the parts are glad. All of you together, not separate, but together, are Christ's body, and each of you is a part of it. So there's two things that I gleaned from this text that are extremely important. Two crucial elements you have to understand about the body, about the community of believers, is that one, it's not homogenized in any way. It's not all the same. There's a ton of variety and diversity in the body of Christ. And two, every part of that is completely needed. It is absolutely needed. All of us are needed to present to the world a proper glance, a proper glimpse of what the body of Christ truly looks like. It's a mosaic of people. Not everyone are the same. Not everyone is the same. Now there's a part in Scripture, there's a section of Scripture that actually illustrates this perfectly. And I could stand up here and I could yell at you for an hour or so, but there's this thing when the church first started, there's a description in the book of Acts that talks about this body, this idea of all of us needed, all of us are important, all of us are precious and valued and esteemed, all of us together, one body together. And it's found in the book of Acts chapter 2. Go there, please. Acts chapter 2, you see the church, Jesus has launched the church. It's just starting out. And look what it says here in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. I love this. One of my, I just constantly reading this to you. Constantly reading this to you. I hope you never get tired of it. It's beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. It says, hi, Lexi. It says, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, like coming together for a common good, and to sharing in meals, including the communion, the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. All the believers came together for that. A deep sense of awe came over them all. And the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day. They met in homes for the Lord's Supper and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God, enjoying the goodwill of all the people, even the ones that weren't like them, that they didn't like so much because we weren't similar. He enjoyed the goodwill of all the people. And what happens when that goes on? Each day the Lord adds to their church. It's growing, it's growing, it's growing. Now jump over to chapter 4, verse 32. It goes on. All the believers were united in heart and mind, and they felt that what they owned was not their own, so they shared everything they had. The apostles testified powerfully to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's great blessing was upon them. Who? On them all. There were no needy people among them, because those who owned land or houses would sell them, bring the money to the apostles to give to those in need. That's crazy what was going on. All the people meeting together. Now think about it. When you hear the word all, it's easy for you to echo back the word all. But what does that mean? Who's all? Well, if you take a walk through the book of Acts where these people are starting to gather, just like we do, what are you going to find? You're going to find doctors, and you're going to find merchants and tax collectors and soldiers and lepers and prostitutes and eunuchs and philosophers and fishermen and tent makers and sorcerers and rabbis. That's who was coming together and sharing everything they had and enjoying the goodwill of all that. Not rabbis hanging out with rabbis, not sorcerers hanging out with sorcerers, but rabbis hanging out with soldiers, and eunuchs hanging out with philosophers, and doctors hanging out with lawyers. Everybody was just coming together. Why? Because of Jesus. It wasn't some club based on what you look like or how you acted. This is a certain small thing of society, and we're all together because we all look this way, and we talk this way, and we act this way. It was all because of what Jesus Christ had done on the cross to forgive them for their sin, and they unified around that. It didn't matter who they were, what walk of life they came from. They came together around Jesus Christ. Some had lots to give. They were extremely resourceful, while some required lots to be given. And back then, the one in that culture that people viewed as less dignified, they viewed with less dignity, they had worth and value, and people esteemed them in the Christian community. And listen, nothing has changed. The Christian community today must gather around those people that many people would think they're less dignified, they're not as important, they don't have as much to offer us. And we need to come around those people and hold them up in value and in worth and come around them. And they might have nothing to bring to the table, but you have lots to bring, and you could help them so that not one guy's got everything and this guy's over here dying, but we could all share. We can help one another and value one another. That's what the body of Christ looks like. The ones who look different, the ones who act different, the ones who dress different, the ones who come into church and raise their hands to worship, or versus those that are quiet and they sit in their seats. And some people might dance before the Lord when they're in the church. And everybody's different. But you know what? Genesis 1:26, God says, "Let us make man in our image to be like us." He didn't speak specifically to middle-aged, Caucasian people from Nebraska. That's not who he said. He said, let us make man in our image. So you know what? Guess what? You look like God. And you look like God. And you look like God. And I look like God. And all of us make up this amazing diamond. You ever look at a diamond, like you hold it up close, and it's got all these different facets on it. It's beautiful. But you pull it away from your face, and what do you see? A diamond. And the body of Christ is like a diamond, but it's got thousands and thousands of different looks to it. And no matter where you look, it's something different, and it's beautiful. But it makes up this one amazing gem of a diamond. Christian community has variety, and it's all needed for the world to see a proper look of the body of Christ. All of us. Now, I want to give you some more scripture. I want to give you some more Bible that talks about this body of Christ and what it should look like. I love this because in churches, and of course not this one, because none of us ever complain about everything here. Amen. Amen. But in churches, we argue about stuff and things that are just, I don't know what it is, man. We just argue about stupid stuff. We argue about stupid stuff. And you look in the Bible, and God has a way of making us look foolish sometimes, like, what's wrong with you people? So we argue about silly things, right? But look at it says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. I love this. In this new life, like if you weren't Christians, but now you are, so you're reborn of a new life, right? And a new community with a new purpose and a new future, right? And so he says, in this life, he doesn't say that they're, you know, Sunday best versus not Sunday best. Should we worship on Sunday morning at 10, or maybe we'll do Saturday night, or maybe we'll do this kind of music or that kind of music. Listen to this. Look at the standard he gives us. Kind of makes me feel a little bit of shame. In this new life, it doesn't matter if you're a Jew or Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, I love this, barbaric or uncivilized, slave or free, Christ is all that matters, and he lives in us all. Right? I mean, that's a motley crew, isn't it? This is not like, oh, he doesn't dress the way I do. Imagine the Capital One ads. You know, the barbarians are coming in and they're farting and burping and picking their nose and they're just misbehaving like crazy. And you're like, man, this guy doesn't act the way I should. But he's saying that it doesn't matter if you're completely uncivilized. Like, I mean, just imagine the conduct of the barbarian. And that should be accepted in your church. This church right here, I can't speak of any other church, but this church, I was reminded by my brother John. And he was sitting in my office the other day, and we're talking about a little bit of turmoil and the people's opinions and what people's sins are too great and too great, you shouldn't come. And that man, and I hope you don't mind, he was rotten to the core. And he reminded me the other day in my office, crying, he said, Moses, you told me you built this church for me. And that's what this place is. It's a hospital for sick, for the barbarian, for the uncivilized, the one who just acts so disgusting, and you would look at him and go, ah, like the leper that Jesus went up to and helped. Those are the people we have to love. Not the ones who just don't dress like you, or the ones that don't like your music, or the ones who think it's too loud, or the ones who think it's too quiet, or the ones who think the lighting's not, whatever, all these things. And you look at this, and you, man, look where God puts the bar. And it should convict us to not be so picky, right? Just, he said you should let the caveman into your church and love that person. You want some more? You guys remember the billboard we put up, right? Years ago, scumbags welcome, right? Mark chapter 2, go there. I got this one memorized. Mark chapter 2. I just give you a little bit more. 13 through 17, right? So here's what happens. So Jesus goes, this should be convicting. Listen. Jesus is walking along the beach, and there's this dude, Matthew. Now, Matthew's a Jew, and Rome is now oppressing the Jews. Like, just imagine Russia or something comes in here and takes over America. Right? Just say for a moment. Now, what would you think if I, as an American, and we're all buddies, I decided to go to work for Russia and take all of your tax money and give it to Russia so they could oppress you? Would you like me? What if I skimmed a little bit more and bled you some more so I could have some too? So I'm taking all your money for my own gain and to give it to your enemy. Would you be buddies with me still? Would we be chums and go, let's go for coffee? That's Matthew. And guess what? Of all the good people that our Savior could have gone up to and said something to, he walked up to that rotten, stinking scum and said, you come be my disciple. Woo! That's crazy, right? That's not who, there's a song, I think it's from Casting Crowns. It says, Jesus paid much too high a price for us to pick and choose who should come. Woo! Right? And that's what Jesus goes up to the worst and says, you come with me, man. I want you to hang out with me. Whoa, man, right? That's not church in America anymore, is it? We got to get back. So what happens? So Matthew, he's all excited, right? So what does he do? He goes to all of his compadres, his team, his squad, his other guys that are everyone hates. He says, man, you won't believe I met this Jesus guy. It's awesome. So come over to my house. We're going to have dinner with this Jesus guy. And so Jesus shows up, and all these rotten people show up, and Jesus got all of his followers, his disciples with him, and they're having this big old dinner. Baptists say amen. And so what happens is these religious folks show up. Boo, right? And they look and they're like, man, Jesus, why is he eating with all this scum? And he didn't, and Jesus didn't wait for his disciples to stand up. No, he shot up that time. He's like, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. I came not to call those who, listen, this is big, who think they are righteous. I came to call those who know that they are sinners. And see, what he means here, you know, he says, you know, the ones who know they're sinners. See, there's a difference between those who know they're sinners and those who think they're righteous. Here's the news. The Bible says in Romans 3:19 says that the law was given not to show how holy and perfect we were, but to show us that the whole world is guilty before God. Everyone's a sinner. Everyone. So Jesus said, I came for all of you. But some of you think, I don't need him. I'm good. You see, that's just a bunch of junk. 1 John says, if you think you're without sin, you just deceive yourself. All of us have sin. You all need Jesus. And Jesus said, I came to get all of you barbaric, uncivilized, crazy people. I want you. And in my Bible, I don't know about yours, it says that those sinners and scum and tax collectors, the ones that nobody wants to hang out with, it says there was many of those in Jesus' group. I like that group. That's my favorite group. And so we put up a billboard to let the world know that that's the kind of church we are. We don't look at people and go, well, you don't look like me, you don't act like me, you don't dress like me, you don't talk like me, you know, this. You're welcome here. And that's the kind of church we've been. Now, that sounds good. We're supposed to be a group of people where everyone is welcome. Well, what would happen if some barbarians came in here? You're holy. That's good. That's a good answer. You got to welcome. But listen, when you stuff people into a place and they're different and they tick you off, it's hard, isn't it? You go through it all the time. We go through it here. You go through it in your 12 to 1500 square foot home with you and your family. Cabin fever, go crazy. Everybody's different. I want you to act the way I want you to act. You want me to act the way I want you to act. And so now let's do this. Let's pour in some barbarians. Let's just pour in some uncivilized people who walk into your beautiful formal dining room with the fine china and they've got boogers hanging out of their nose, and they're farting, and they're burping, and cussing like a sailor, and they're smoking a cigarette in your living room. Like, who wants that, right? That wouldn't be easy, right? But see, look at the Word of God tells us to love them. That they may seem a part of society that's less dignified, but they're to be esteemed and valued and loved and ministered to. That's who they are. So how do we pull this thing off? Because it sounds good that we would do that. That if Mel Gibson with Braveheart, all these people come roaring in, there's some Vikings and they're drinking grog and doing all this kind of crazy stuff in here, how would we pull that thing off? Seems like it'd be kind of tough. I mean, we're in a church in 2015, and even though it doesn't feel like we have air conditioning, we have air conditioning, and we've got comfortable seats, and we've got couches, and we got a kitchen and a lounge, and we got projector, we got all this nice stuff. But yet we still fight and squabble all the time. I just envision Jesus on this cross going, please stop, kids. Why are you doing? Like, I went and I died for you. And why are you guys holding this, why are you holding this against me, Mark? Why are you holding that sin against Moses when I already paid for that? Why are you doing that? So how do we pull this thing off? You go back to the book of Colossians, where he says it doesn't matter if they're Jew or Gentile, and the barbarians and uncivilized, crazy people going in there. This is what it says. Verse 12, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must. How much wiggle room is in the word must? Hold up, tell me, show me. None. You know, it's great to feel convicted and love the Lord and want to just be thankful. And I want to do this because I love the Lord, and that's good. But sometimes, where does that start? Obedience. Obedience. See, to pull off community, there's certain things you have to do. You must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. In other words, he says, to pull this thing off, when the barbarians walk in and they're doing disgusting things and you want to respond in like manner, when they come and they fart on you or they punch you or they push you out of the line to get your food, you want to do what they deserve. And he's like, no, give them what they don't deserve. Don't give them what they deserve. As a matter of fact, Jesus says that when people act rotten, yeah, they act rotten, but you don't act in like manner. You act toward them the way you want them to act toward you. It's just here again. It's the same thing. He says, kindness. Someone comes into your church and they don't act the way you want them to act, and they're acting like jerks and heels and disrespectful and all. You pull off community, and the whole church is healthy, growing, and full of love if you don't act back the way they did and you act kind. Humility. I make $100,000 a year and you're a barbarian. How can I serve you, Mr. Barbarian? It's the only way to pull this thing off. Gentle and patient. This is awesome. Make allowance for each other's faults. Do you know what that means? That means depositing something into someone's bank account. You're married. If you didn't make an allowance for Kyle for his faults, means that when you wake up in the morning, you say, Lord, I know he's going to tick me off. And I'm cool with it already. Free pass. That's what an allowance for a fault is. I already know you're going to make me mad. I already know you're going to tick me off and offend me. And I'm saying in advance, before I even meet you, I'm telling you, Kelly, I'm allowing you to mess up, and I will not respond in like measure. That's making allowance for fault. I love this. And forgive anyone who offends you. Whew. Who would agree that's real tough? Listen. Anyone who offends you, but here's the thing. There's a verse in Romans that says, all things work out for the good to those who love the Lord, called to his purpose. Like, if you want things to work out good, that's how it works out good. You cannot hold the grudge. If you want this church, this community to excel and grow and be healthy and growing and full of love, you must forgive people that offend you. Even if they're barbaric. Even if they're just horrendous, you have to. Why? Because it's the way we pull off genuine community with some level of success. Now look at it also says, though, and this is you got to remember. It says, remember. Now think back. The Lord forgave you, so you must forgive them. So when you're trying to forgive someone's long list of offenses, it's hard, right? They're barbarians. It's terrible, right? So in order to do that, pause from that and turn back to that and go, wow, look at my list that you forgave. Makes forgiving their list easier. So above all that, you clothe yourself, like you protect yourself. And not only is clothing to protect you from the outside, but it also is to display something that people see. Genuine Christian community, to see Jesus, to be his witness. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. That's what holds the community together. Perfect harmony and let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. There's only one way for this thing to work. Is that above all things, we clothe ourselves in love. That no matter what happens, if someone offends you, you have to forgive them for it. Release them and yourself from that prison of misery and bring back the body into perfect harmony. Harmony, 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 harmony. Harmony, that's a big word. That's the name of our pastor's group. Paul says in Romans 12, 16, to live in harmony with each other. With each other. There's no such thing as living in harmony away from each other. Harmony, harmony, harmony. There's a guy by the name of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and he once said that music is the universal language of all mankind. I don't know if that's the gospel or not, but it sounds good. It sounds good. Let me ask you guys a favor. I want you to help me. How many people, if we were to sing, if I was to give you this microphone, how many people in this room would say that they sing with a high voice? Raise your hand. A higher voice. Come on, Frank. You don't have a high voice. Nobody in here sings with a higher voice? Two people? How many people say that they sing with a low, like a bass or a baritone? Raise your hand. Couple. Okay, and then how many people think that they're somewhere in the middle? Raise your hand. You're high. No, I mean, you're not high. You sing high. Edit that. So we're all different, right? We got different voices, right? I feel like singing. I feel like singing. I feel like singing. I do. Anyone else feel like singing? I feel like singing. I feel like singing. I feel like singing that. I feel like, you got to do me a favor though, man. I need a little encouragement. One, I need the lights to come down. I need them off. Kill those spotlights. And I need you to help me. Because I feel like singing, but I'm a little bit scared. But if you guys could encourage me, I would sing. No, you have to do better than that. Okay, so listen. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Listen, I need some help. I didn't want you to sing with me. Who has a high voice in here? Who has a high voice? I want you to do me a favor. With everything you got, I want you to belt that tune out right now, just the way I did. Sing, 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 sing. Sing, sing, sing. Come on. Come on, high voices. Come on. Okay, that was good. That was good, right? Okay. Now, hold on. How about the bass and the baritone people? Okay, seriously. I need bass and baritone. Bust out that song right now. Come on, let's hear it. Amazing. That was good. Now let's just see if God knows what he's talking about. Romans 15, 5 and 6. May God, who gives patience and encouragement, help you live in complete harmony with each other, as is fitting for followers of Christ Jesus. Then all of you can join together with one voice, giving praise and glory to God, the Father of Lord Jesus Christ. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Woo! I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Woo! Who thinks that sounded the best? Out of all the ones we did, was it the high, was it the low, or was it when we all praise with one voice? That's what I wanted. Harmony, harmony. Harmony is when all the different voices come together to put together something more beautiful than any one single part can do by itself. And that's the body of Christ. And that's what you just heard. Okay? That's what you just heard. Now, people have always been part of a community. They've always been part of a community. Man, that was fun. We've only been part of a community. But people like Achan back here in Joshua chapter 7, they're selfish and they hurt the community. Let me tell you something. There's too many Achans in the Christian community today. It's too many. And that's not a time to look at some other people. It's a time to look in the mirror, myself included. But listen, if you think of others before yourself, if you will esteem those that seem different and don't seem like they have much to offer you, if you will give an allowance for fault to the uncivilized barbarian, if you will forgive all who have offended and hurt you, just like Christ forgave you, then you're really living out genuine Christian community. Then, and only then, are you truly doing church. That's what a church looks like. Now, coming to the end here, I'd like to tell you something. In Hebrews chapter 8, the writer says that we have a better covenant now. We have a better covenant. And it really has everything to do with our community. In Hebrews 8, 6, it says that our covenant now, this New Testament covenant, this agreement, this thing, this deal he's got with us is way better than it was way back when in the Old Testament. And it plays out most in community. See, in Joshua chapter 7, the community is used to execute God's judgment on the sinner. It says, confess your sin and be honest about it, Achan. And he does. And what happens is all of Israel executes God's judgment against sin, and they stone and burn him and his whole family. That's terrible, isn't it? But now Jesus has died on the cross to pay for your sin. And all the judgment and wrath of God has been laid upon Christ so that you are holy and blameless and without fault. And so now, instead of the community exercising God's judgment, look what happens in James chapter 5, verse 16. If you have a Bible, you can go there. James chapter 5, verse 16. Look at the difference then as opposed to now. Because Christ went to the cross to already pay for your sin. It says to confess your sins to one another, just like they made this guy Achan do to the community. But instead of them stoning and burning him and exercising judgment upon him, judgment's already been made upon Christ for you. And so when you bring these sins to the community, it says confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. So instead of judgment, the community around you brings blessing and encouragement and peace and healing. The community isn't together to condemn one another, to slander one another, to gossip about one another, to blame one another, to accuse and to shame one another. And the church can't do that. No, actually, if you read the scriptures, you see that the heart of God actually leans toward the downtrodden and the hurt, the lowest members of our society. And these people usually have lots of flaws and problems and needs. But we are to love them. And we are to include them into our family. And I leave you with this precious section of Scripture. I'm just going to read it and be done. The heart of God is displayed here in John 17, verse 20. Jesus Christ says, I am praying not only for these disciples who sit before me, but to also for all of those who will ever believe in me through their message. And let me tell you who that is. You. You believe in Jesus because of the message of the Scriptures. You read Paul's writing. You read Peter's writing. You read John's writing. You read this and you came to faith as a result of it. So Jesus is praying the following prayer for us. I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us, so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, so they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. The divisions and the fighting and the squabbling and the looking at sin lists and comparing and the slander and the accusation and the blame and the shame that we lob on top of each other needs to stop. We have to give an allowance for fault. To experience this unity, God gives us the community. That's where you experience us being one with each other and with Him. It's right here. And if we're to pull this thing off so that the world will know that Jesus actually came from heaven to save them, they have to see us forgive everyone who offends us. They have to see us make an allowance for fault, already saying it's okay if you wrong me, I'm going to allow that. And I will not bite back at you. They have to see us forgive one another just as Jesus forgave you. That's the only way this thing's going to work. I pray, I beg that you take this to heart. When the church grows and God starts blessing, the devil starts messing, and you need to be ready. And that stuff here, this is how we fight. Our fight is not against flesh and blood. It's not against each other. It's against the enemy who makes us gossip, verse one. The ones who look, say, well, look at his pile. Look at her pile. Look what she did. Look at I did. Look what they did. And you know what nobody's doing? Nobody's looking at what he did. That's the problem. Let's be a church that always constantly looks at what he did. Amen? And ask that whoever's going to pass out communion would come up, please. I want to pray with you. We'll take the communion elements into our hands and we'll take it together as a family. Lord, I am extremely thankful that the body of Christ isn't all like me. I'm thankful, Lord, that the body of Christ is not all like anyone in this room. I'm thankful, Lord, that all of us are a facet of the greater diamond. I'm thankful, Lord, that every single one of us reflects who you are. I'm thankful, Lord, that you've given us the Holy Spirit to be able to pull this thing off that we've learned here tonight. To not just look aside from someone who doesn't dress like us or act like us or might have this quirk or that hang-up or this style, all these things that we squabble about. I'm thankful, Lord, that you gave us a bar that is so beyond that, so beyond the trivial things that we squabble about. That we would welcome in those who offer us nothing except perhaps a smile. That would offer us nothing other than an opportunity for us to love them. I thank you that you've painted a picture for us that we can now see. Something that we could live up to. Lord, I pray that as these elements go out and we take some quiet moments, that perhaps there's a relationship, an incident, something we need to forgive, a person we need to give an allowance for fault, someone that we need to show tender-hearted mercy to that we've been wicked to, someone that we need to show kindness to that we've been mean to. Lord, we welcome you to send your Holy Spirit deep into the darkest parts of our heart right now for these few minutes to do that work so that your body can be healthy and growing and full of love.